And a shamrock. It is a shamrock either way. But this pub is not a home. I don't remember the lyrics.
Is this all theme
this
song?
Is not the bar I know.
I would give it all away to hear it have you stay.
So what is this?
January 1st, 1997.
Sono Cino Kiyo.
Chapter 3, Stardust Crusaders.
So what are you fine folks drinking tonight? I'm still sipping up my branded One Piece. I'm not going to let it go to waste.
Still, yeah, it's pretty big.
He's going to be sipping on that shit for like a couple weeks, maybe years. Oh gosh.
I guess I'm taking over ball tending today. So what about you, Sad?
I am having the biggest glass of Benadryl that you have.
Ooh.
Okay. And add some toothpaste on top of that. That's for some extra flavor.
Oh yeah, gotta keep my teeth clean while I'm taking care of my allergies. Y'all know my allergies are rough. I appreciate that.
And you, Mr. Sedity.
Can I have just a glass of H2O? Behold the H2.
Some oxygen, so, and I'll put some whipped cream on that as well.
I don't
know. So today's subject, we went through part one. We went through part two.
And now
we're not going to quite go through part three because we're going through half of part three.
It's way too humongous to go through the entire part in one sitting.
So the reason we're doing this is for really our own sanity's sake. And also it's easier to keep notes on 24 episodes and 48 episodes. My dog is happy, but anyways.
Because we're recording a Maple Shamrock. Do you want your dog to be happy? Watch the
press and like button.
So
cutting this in half because some of those could say this, we'll give our base thoughts, not going too deep into it. Is a long ass part. And
exactly.
It's cool.
Yeah.
But also frustrating at the same time, and I think we can all somewhat agree on that.
Yes, indeed.
Oh, absolutely.
This was the first time that I thought, God damn, this is really taking a long time.
I think Aoki had a lot of ideas, which he fleshed out better in part 4 and 5, because when you look at part 4 and 5, part 4 is the goofy, more relaxed parts of part 3, and part 5 is the more action parts of part 3, more concentrated.
Well, there's clearly a better tone when it comes down to it, as you progress. Like, goddamn.
I feel like Aoki had so many ideas, he was throwing them all at once.
Here's the thing. I feel like the theme of this part actually goes hand in hand with what Araki was doing himself. Like, the entire theme of the part, I'd say, is growth in terms of Jotaro and just the whole Crusader crew.
Now here's another thing. Before we go too far deep to this, and you can never convince me otherwise, part 3 is the most important Jotaro part in Jotaro history. Without part 3, you won't get anything.
So that means that you can skip part 1 and 2, right?
Yes, if you want people to lynch you.
Exactly. Don't skip parts. A message from Concerned Children's Advertisers.
Well, actually, Part 3 is actually something that you could go in as a standalone. Like, there's
but
some
you
explaining.
Should not.
You should not, but
yes.
Things are explained to a point that if a newcomer just casually starts a Part 3, they explain enough for you to understand.
Yeah. No, you can understand hopping in at, like, any point.
I always say start from the beginning, but also start whatever interests you.
Yeah.
But no. Yes. Just don't... Whatever you do, do not start with the mother's basement route.
Well, here's the thing. I guess I'll get into this real quickly.
Mm-hmm.
He gave you a route. What I'm saying is, you can start at any part, and if that part captivates you, maybe you will want to go back or move forward. Just take a look and see what makes you interested and click on that. That's really my advice, because all parts can stand on their own.
Yeah, well, yeah. I guess that's the point. I guess I see what you're saying.
I'm not saying go in his stupid route.
Yeah, don't fucking do that to yourself.
I'm saying you can start with any part if one part... Like, if you're more interested in, like, the Mafia side of things, you may want to start with Part 5 and see... And if Part 5... You like Part 5, you can start from the beginning and then catch up to that.
If you ask me personally, if you really, really want to watch JoJo, you need to get yourself a friend who won't shut the fuck up about JoJo. Now, for most friend groups, I'm usually that friend. I've convinced many people to watch it. Some have loved it. Other people dropped it after about 10 episodes or so. But you know what? The ones who loved it, mission accomplished. And now some of them have become the annoying friend who want to watch JoJo.
And the cycle repeats itself. Yep.
So, yeah, Part 3 is, by fact, the most historically important part.
Yes.
Because this is where Araki makes most of the themes and stuff that we recognize for many, many parts.
And the most money. So much money. So
Hells
much
yeah.
Moolah. So much merchandise.
And we'll briefly talk about this right now. Part 3 has the most adaptations.
Yes, more than one.
Holy shit, yeah.
It has the manga, it has the more anime, but it also has an old OVA that went backwards.
Yeah, it's got two set series from AAAP, Studio AAAP, and it has the David Productions release, which is the modern one. And also a bunch of games. And they were the only characters to... They only used Stardust Crusaders for Jump Force.
And it doesn't even stop there, because it has a Super Nintendo RPG, only in Japan.
Yeah.
It has a fighting game.
Oh,
which
yes.
Which I have been streaming.
Yes, indeed.
Character Future is bellissimo.
Oh, it's not even meh. It's a really damn good fighting game. Like, it's a Capcom fighting game.
It's has some great premise. It's just... The storylines can sometimes be cringeworthy and sometimes not.
There are some people who know more about that game than they do about JoJo. What's his name? Max Mofo, I think his name. No, that's a different guy completely. Maximilian.
Maximilian, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And finally, there's actually a fan-made RPG called The Seven Sand User, which is also well-known.
Yeah, which is me. I'm The Seven Sand User.
Technically, it's all of you.
Dude, the stand ideas in that game are actually pretty cool.
Hells yeah.
But anyways, this part, whether we have problems with it or not, it hit a chord.
It certainly did, and definitely that's what Araki wanted to accomplish.
So are we ready to go into this thing, or do any
Let's
of you
stop
have...
stalling!
I like how I'm appreciating your stalling.
We did it for Vanity Pots, went into the history, and was adapted. Mm. This is not stalling, sad.
I feel we should say off the bat, even from before we did our re-research, our original experience with it, how we felt about it before, because this is something we extremely differ on.
The reason I brought this up was Part 3 was the first thing I saw of JoJo. Back in the day, there was these magazines called Shonen Jump.
Mm-hmm. And what's that? I'm kidding.
Sometimes.
I said, what's that? I'm kidding.
They still go on each month.
Yeah, they do.
Pretty much each month, and they sold a chapter of quote-unquote new mangas. A lot of it was actually really old mangas that never came to the U.S., and it was just getting their mangas.
Well, it's new to...
like, they were selling Sam Junk and stuff like that, which now I know were pretty fucking old.
Mm-hmm.
Age is only... Oh, no, I shouldn't...
No! What? No! No!
So, I saw that, and I saw the story, and like I did back then, I looked for a pirating site to find a manga. And it was surprisingly difficult back then, and then I found out there was stuff before that, after reading like half of it online.
Mm.
So legally, I went to the beginning.
Quote unquote.
There was no legal way of going through JoJo back then, man.
No.
Now there is, but back then there really wasn't. And I probably saw the Solemn Jump original publishing line stopped halfway.
Oof. Oh no.
Back then, fans were not interested in JoJo, which is ludicrous to say.
If only they knew.
The cultural phenomenon.
You had no choice back then.
Mm-hmm. And how did you feel about Part 3 in particular?
I think I liked it at the time.
And later on,
I got spiteful because of how fans back then put it on a pedestal and they completely sit it on Part 5 all the time.
Yeah.
Remember, these were before the anime and stuff was out, and I was going through Part 5, and I was falling in love with it. And then everybody crapped on Part 5, saying it was a ripoff of Part 3. So I kind of turned bitter at it at that point.
Yeah, shit. Yeah,
the roles are pretty much reversed at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Times have changed, but...
How about you?
Well, Remy... Part 3 was kind of this, as I was watching JoJo, like, for parts 1 and 2, I'm like, man, how is this gonna tie into part 3? Like, everybody says that part 3 is freaking amazing, and from what I know, from what I knew of it, it's like, this is gonna be, like, a grand conclusion of, like, of a huge part, and I was like, man, if I wanted to end JoJo, I would, like, I could just end it here. Like, this is going to be so hype. Oh, goodness. It was overhyped for me. And that showed. My very first frickin', the very first episode, I'm like, this is our protagonist? Oh, no.
I think you also went into it with probably maybe the wrong mindset, if that's where you're going with this.
Well, and you know, like, it was long. Like, this, like, at this point, I think I was spoiled by the fact that, like, parts 1 and 2 were so quickly paced, and I really enjoy the fast-paced stuff, don't get me wrong. Like, longer things are great, too. But this one just felt like it droned on and on in comparison. Maybe it's because I was watching part 2 or 1 and 2 before. But holy shit. By the end of it, I'm like, by the end of the first half, I'm like, that's it? That, like, wait a minute. Hang on. There's still another part? What is this? Oh my goodness. And also, I started with the anime on that. And yes, I had mixed feelings about hearing Walk Like an Egyptian as the ending after Roundabout was such a goddamn banger.
Holy like, hell.
Oh, wow.
You were... Here's me. I went into it first time actually enjoying it because I always had a thing for the Siren Badasses back then. Not so much nowadays.
Oh, yeah. I went through the entire anime via like, God damn, when is Jotaro gonna get likable? That was literally a thought in the back of my mind. Because I hate those kinds of characters.
Now, here's... In the defense of Jotaro, real quick, Dad. He's not the same type of character that we'd get from a Jonathan or a Joseph.
Of course. And I get that.
And I like that they went with a different route to make him stand out compared to the other two protagonists.
JoJo is incredibly different, and I appreciate that.
Like, I
just doesn't mean I have to like it.
I understand he can be frustrated sometimes, but I do think if we had another energetic hero, it'd be too much like Joseph too soon because he was peak energy at the time.
Joseph was peak energy. Abso-fucking-lutely.
Yeah, sugar rushed all the time.
Like, if we had Josuke right after Joseph, it might have been too much.
Well, I think my like of Josuke definitely spurned from my was definitely spawned from my dislike of Jotaro. I will definitely.
And he bounces off Jotaro very well.
But I'm saying, if we had like somehow Jotaro be like Josuke right after Joseph, it probably would not.
It wouldn't have the same effect. Himself. Absolutely. Yeah. There's
now that being said, I'm not the biggest fan of Jotaro. I'm just saying, in Devil's Advocate, that his personality does have its pluses.
I can agree with that, but like, not my kind of character. I do not like Jotaro as a protagonist. I do not.
Oh.
So anyway, Sardine, what did
you? What was your impressions? Yes, now that we've shit on it thoroughly.
Okay. You shit on it.
Well, okay. Yes, but
before we begin, 2 weeks ago or a week ago, I made a little pic collage of my favorite anime characters of all time. My five favorite anime characters of all time. Why don't you take a look here? I'll put it up on screen. This is what's in the group chat. And you might notice who's in the dead middle.
Yes.
I said to myself, I want one character per series. So of everyone in JoJo, Jotaro is my favorite character. And it's not even close. But
I love how... That's quite interesting. You have about two protagonists in there.
Oh, yeah. No, I've
and
got two. And...
Yeah.
One is a main character, and one is dead.
Yeah, and you have poor Minato over there just... Hey.
He hit me the most emotionally. But he's the reason why I like Naruto.
They should have made a Minato prequel series, just saying.
You know, it probably...
Yeah,
well.
No, I would actually really like that. So my experience of Part 3. So basically, I started watching JoJo when Part 5 first came out. I watched it in order, of course. Me and my friend Dylan, who featured on the very first video on this channel, actually. We were watching it simultaneously together. He was a bit faster because I'm slow as crap when it comes to anime. And he would be like, yo, Joseph did this, Joseph did that. I'm like, okay, cool. Like, I get that. And I'd get to the episodes, I'm like, oh yeah, cool. Joseph's neat. I really like Joseph. He's cool. And then I get to Jotaro. And I'm like his introduction, I'm like, yo, what? Halfway through, I'm like, oh, whoa. I really like this guy. And then by the end of it, I'm like, oh my God. And then obviously I watched the rest of the parts and I was like, whoa, this is like, I love this show. I love this series. But I love Jotaro more than these other guys.
And... Well, I think also you, and this is a beautiful thing about Jozo, each main character will click differently with others. Like, I click with Gino more than any of you guys, and you guys would never get it.
Oh, yeah, no. And Giorno is my least favorite JoJo. Yeah, by a long mile.
So that's the main thing about JoJo.
He's down there for
different
me.
Different characters click for different people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And for some reason, Jotaro just gave me that click. And I'm like, he's so cool as a character.
And yet...
Star Platinum is okay, I guess. But Jotaro himself, I really like him.
Okay, open the game.
So, the series starts with a flashback, kinda. With some treasure hunters, I guess?
Yeah, like...
Beagles?
I think they're like...
they're just like
sea explorers. Maybe like... Okay.
Yeah, maybe like... It looks like a fishing boat or something, but they're like... I don't know.
Well, these people... pick up the coffin with the word "deal" on it.
Okay, but in... All right. No, go on. Go on ahead.
And we get kind of like a quick time step, and the Sea Dragon Foundation finds the coffin empty, and nobody on the boat.
Guys, I think it's AC/DC.
Oh shit.
Okay, so it actually starts different in the manga. It starts immediately in the prison.
What? Actually, no, it doesn't.
Yeah, actually, in the manga...
I swear.
No, yeah. It
doesn't now, here's the confusing thing about the manga. That opening scene was kind of like the epilogue scene of Part 2. So the anime decided to kind of pick... page it a little differently, so we start with this and then go to the prison. So you're both right.
Yay. Everybody wins, which means nobody wins.
Fair enough.
So we meet Jotaro real quick, and he's in prison.
Yeah, great. That's all done.
Which is a pretty, I'll be honest, it's a pretty cool introduction with him just being menacing the city into prison. The prison guard saying, "Hey, leave," and then he just takes the gun and goes, "I have an evil spirit."
Yeah.
Like, come on, that is pretty badass.
Yeah, the spirit takes the gun, and like he reaches for it, and the spirit's hand reaches out further. So that's.
And then he tries to shoot himself and. This
so
evil spirit, quote-unquote, stops the bullet with its bare hands.
While also providing him, like, manga and drinks.
And a stereo, and, like, I gotta wonder, knowing what we know,
here's a funny thing. In the dub, and I'm pretty sure in all buzzards, the prison's got like, he has a solid jump magazine!
Yeah. With a can of Heineken, there's no better way to spend your weekend.
Yeah, he has a Shonen Jump magazine and an ice cold bottle of Heineken. And a set of Dolby stereo speakers.
What a monster.
I don't think they're trying to be funny, but holy man, it was pretty hilarious, honestly.
Oh, so, yeah.
The squad pulls up, as in the squad being some random old guy, and this wonderful fortune teller.
Hey, you cannot gloss over the pure fucking soul that is Holly Cujo.
I'm deeply sorry. That annoying bitch.
Oh.
I'm quoting Jotaro.
he's a 17-year-old kid. He's in that phase that he would say that.
I'm an 18-year-old kid. I'm allowed to say it.
Oh my gosh, Holly is such the...
Holly is the best.
Yeah. How does that office meme go? I've only known Holly for like 10 minutes, but if anything were to happen to her, I would kill everyone in this room and then myself.
I'm so disappointed in you that you said The Office. That is from Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Fuck. I did realize that as I was saying. I'm like, fuck, I'm gonna get myrtleized. Yes, but I...
That's one of the only ones I know.
I committed to it, though. I'm not apologizing.
Damn. We're gonna be hard.
That's one of the very few ones I know. So I'm insulted. If I know.
Yeah. Yeah. I can't believe I said The Office. No.
My favorite part about this entire scene is just like how Jotaro is just like, shut up, you annoying bitch. And she's just like, okay. Whatever.
Well, considering that, like, everything, like, in Holly's imagination, all right, she's like saying, oh, how could my perfect little boy Jotaro get thrown in prison? He hasn't done anything wrong. And
would you
like
say Holly is to say so?
Yes.
What if it's not?
I mean, literally her nickname is Seiko, so
so she is say so.
Exactly.
I've been watching way too much Whole Alive.
What if it's not Holly's imagination? What if it's Jotaro's imagination and he didn't say that and he didn't have all these things? He was just like sitting there in the cell.
Maybe the evil spirit corrupted him and that's why he was that
He's
way.
Actually really skinny and he actually looks like a normal 17-year-old. He just thinks he's this huge buff guy.
Boy, this is going beyond meta levels, guys.
Oh god. Everything is 18th century England. Wait, 20th. Oh, god damn it. I did centuries wrong.
but yeah, Holly is nice. Too pure for my tastes.
And Holly is the very definition of protect. Like, you don't...
Nope.
No.
Yeah.
He hasn't got red hair.
What?
We will get to that later.
Okay. I Holly is fucking great to me, alright? Don't you dare ruin this for me. Don't you dare ruin this for me.
Oh, wow, Holly's great. But she gave birth to Jotaro, and you hate Jotaro, so she can't be that great, can she?
Oh, God.
Hey. The sins... How does that go? The sins of the father or something of the sort?
In this case.
The sins of the parents are not born upon the son.
Exactly. So the purity in this case of the mother is not cast upon the son. That ruined everything.
Yeah. Oof. This is going to be a long, long 24 episodes.
Indeed.
So after his
his little temper tantrum,
Joseph comes in with a mysterious BFF
and a wonderful
beard. Mean, he needed a his replacement Caesar.
Well, Joseph, this is going to go off that, but he kind of looks like Sean Connery to me. I don't want to seize it.
No, I can see it. I can understand where you're coming from with that. I always thought, like,
I'll be honest, when I first played the PS1 fighting game, I thought it was Sean Connery.
Oh my goodness. Oh my gosh.
Who are you? Listen.
Oh, have all of you been seeing everyone is comparing KSI to Avdol?
Wait, what?
KSI?
KSI is like, he's like
the dude that fought Logan Paul?
Oh, I forgot that even happened.
Yes.
Yeah, no, he's like the number one British YouTuber ever, and PewDiePie made like a really silly drawing of him, and now everyone's comparing him to Alex.
That's amazing.
Dude, the only real tuba stuff I know right now is VTubers. I'm so deep in that rabbit hole.
God.
It's such rabbits. A comfy rabbit hole, though.
I'm hunting rabbits.
Dude, me and Sean send clips to each other all day.
That's awesome.
Okay, so Abdul and, well,
we don't know his
old
name
Joe.
Yet.
Yeah.
Old Joe is
old
like,
Joseph
yo,
strolls
bro.
Up to the party and he's like, hey, the fuck is this little shitbag doing saying this shit? I'm going to straighten him the fuck out. Dude's
and then
in
he gets
jail.
His best friend to do it.
Yeah.
And he's like, you take care of this kid for me.
Yeah.
And then we get introduced to Muhammad Al-Duo, who is actually pretty dope.
Yeah, he is.
He's very underrated.
Now,
I
here's
really
the thing.
Like...
Rewatching this show, I never realized how underrated Al-Duo was and how underappreciated he really feels on a second watch because he's so good at what he does.
He's got that
exactly.
Swagger.
He's so good. Like, he's the best type of supporting character you can have.
His introduction in the manga was actually fire.
Literally.
No pun intended. But yes, like, actually, like, this dude gets almost a full page to himself from his introduction. He was that badass. Yeah.
So,
like,
oh my god.
People always talking about Calculating or Polymorph, but you never hear a duo, and that's the same.
Yeah.
Because this guy has charisma, likability, and there's an overall coolness to him that is not overstated, and it's actually understated in a good way.
Oh, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
And
he's also great at keeping
the rise, and everyone's starting to freak out. What could be rising to temperatures so high? Oh wow! It seems like Avdol has a scary ghost too. Oh no! We might need to get Scooby in the gang. There's two ghosts.
Zoink, Scoob!
Or is there?
I don't want to watch Scooby Doo again. Anyway.
So.
Yeah, we get our first kind of fight. And this is introduced into pretty much stand battles, and it's a great introduction. We get a little bit, like, without oversowing their abilities, we kind of see what stands can do.
Well,
for
exactly.
Now, though, did you ever see Machoke? The Pokemon?
Yish.
Yeah.
Everyone is Machoke. All the stands are just Machoke. It's just, it's like an Alolan Machoke, a Kanto Machoke. It's like all the stands right now are just different versions of Machoke. Or
I guess,
Machamp.
I guess. But
fun.
As soon as Joshua gets ready to fight, Abdul's like, I got him out of the cell. I did my piece. See ya, bitches.
Yeah. Like, he's ready to be like, whoa, whew. I was ready to fucking kill him if I had to, but hey, nope.
He walked out of cell.
My job is done. So,
And Jojo's like, did I really fall for the oldest trick?
He fell for it! You fell for it, fool! You fell for it, fool! Crossfire Hurricane! It almost fucking works.
These three giant bully people plus Holly go to a cafe, and man, the character design on these three is ridiculous because they are ridiculously bully.
Well, we knew that from Joseph already, that he would continue to be fucking the Chad of Chads.
The
and,
yonked
man, yeah.
Is Joseph.
And yeah, we knew that. But then, that's definitely those genes were passed down to Jotaro. They kind of skipped a generation, but,
they tend to skip a generation.
Have you seen George the II? That dude was a monster.
Yeah. I was more referring to George II. He wasn't... No, it's actually kind of buff.
That's literally what I said, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm
George the First was a monster as well, but, like, George II, you see him and you're like, oh, how did we not get a part focusing on this dude?
Because he dies easily.
Indeed.
Because he has no hammon.
But we pretty much end the episode off with Joseph explaining Dio and explaining our main conflict. Like, our main conflict hasn't happened yet, but we got to the point that we kind of know Dio's back. Dio's in Jonathan's body, because of course he is.
Yeah.
Yep.
Soulmates.
And one thing I would give Damek credit is one thing they retrospectively added in the anime, which was not something they did originally, was give everybody the star buff mark.
Yes, yes.
So that was something that's actually kind of cool on a rewatch bonus. Well, if you relook at the manga, that was never planned.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, something I want to bring up. That I realized there was some incredible foreshadow to, like, the whole Dio stealing Jonathan's body. Do you remember in part one, after that rugby game, and Jonathan and Dio are, like, celebrating, and Jonathan's like, with your brains and my...
And Dio, who's going to become a lawyer.
Yeah! And Jonathan says, like, we did it, Dio! With your brains and my brawn, we could do anything!
Oh.
That was literally a line in that...
that's some bullshit right now.
Yeah, yeah!
That is the best accident ever.
Right?
That was never planned, probably, but that was almost older levels of foreshadowing.
Yeah, almost. I just wanted to point that out, because, like...
The only difference is Oda would do it on purpose.
Yes, Oda would.
Oda did reference, like, something in chapter, like, 900 or whatever, to chapter, like, 2.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Legit.
That man is... I worry about him.
I'm just hoping...
If he remembers about that, I worry if he remembers everything.
He might, actually.
I personally would not want to remember everything about everything.
But yeah, that's how the first episode kind of ends, and it's a pretty good introduction.
Yeah.
So yeah, we're basically told it is the Joestar's destiny. Joseph Joestar and Jotaro Joestar, sort of, and Abdul to stop Dio.
I love how our duo is just kind of awkwardly there. There's so much I love about our duo just being here.
There's a panel in the manga, actually, in this point that I remember. Like when Joseph's explaining what Dio is, and, like, you see, while he's explaining it, you see, like, they're striking a pose, like, Joseph, Abdul, Jotaro, they're looking all cool, and then there's Holly that's, like, a head shorter than everyone, just clinging to Jotaro for dear life as she's, as the picture of Dio is over top. I'm like, oh, you're trying, Holly.
I mean... Them JoJo's do be posing, though.
Oh, yeah.
What is your favorite? Like, just a bit of a... Because we definitely don't have enough side tangents. It's been, like, an hour or still on episode one. But what is your favorite JoJo pose?
I don't know. I don't remember the poses, honestly.
Dang. That's either... I find myself... honestly, like, that's a tough question.
I don't think about posing.
What about
something?
Oh, no, okay.
Yeah, I seem. Well, the first one that always sticks out in my mind is fucking Dio's pose.
Oh, I thought you were gonna say Polnareff with his anti-gravity pose.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The Dio, and then the next one that comes to mind is either Giorno or Josuke.
Fair enough. I mean, my favorite is the... It's kind of cheating because it's two poses in one, but it's the Caesar Joseph pose when they first meet Wamuu.
Oh, yeah! I love that one.
Caesar's doing the Jonathan, and then, like, Joseph's, like, pointing back, and it's cool.
So, to not get too distracted, on the second episode... The episode starts off with Jojo going to school, and we get a ridiculous amount of groupies around him.
Yes, Mom. A giant gold chain is definitely part of the school uniform.
Okay.
Yeah, and then we meet a certain artist. Rohan
Kishibe. Rohan Kishibe!
Well, before that, these groupies... Why do they like him so much?
I don't know, but we get... a fun fact is that we get...
Because we have two of them arguing about one being fat-chested or whatever, and...
Ugly no boob.
It which is incredible foreshadowing to a later battle, as weird as it is.
In fairness, I can understand why, because first of all, look at him. He is huge.
Yeah.
Second of all, chicks dig that personality.
This is also the 80s, by the way. I think we should preface that with that. When that stereotype was huge.
Then the groupies are, whatever, he tells him to shut the hell up, as he does
and
with women.
And then suddenly he falls down the stairs with his leg getting cut.
Yeah. It was an accident?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, it was an accident. And also it pans to this nice guy, he has red hair, he's cool. He's got cherry earrings. He's just painting a picture of Jotaro because he looks cool.
Let's probably introduce him. Yeah, this is our introduction to probably one of the more popular characters in this part.
Noriaki Kakuin.
And Kakuin is actually one of my personal favorite characters in this part.
Yeah. I mean...
He has a very cool... Once again, a lot of the sub-characters have this nice, understated vibe.
He's very
to them.
Suave.
Well, I mean, after Jotaro cuts his leg falling down the stairs, this dude walks up to him and is like, "Hey, you cut your leg. Here. Have a handkerchief to wipe that up." Dude's a nice guy.
Yeah, see?
Yes, he's just looking out for the most meddling poses in the story watch, which is justified, but still.
Well, hey, it's just because he's also hulking and huge, but I guess it's just like a virus that spreads through blood, I guess.
Oh!
You either are born through it, or you touch someone and immediately become extremely buff. It happens to the best of us.
Wish that would happen to me.
Wait, what?
Not really.
But anyways, there's a very good point to bring up here, though. Kakyoin is a transfer student. And so and as we all know, if you're a transfer student in an anime, you immediately have everybody lusting after you. So he kind of steals her, he kind of steals Jotaro's groupies.
They're both hot.
Yeah.
But they still don't know how to share thoughts.
Exactly.
So wait, is Jotaro and Kakuin the thoughts?
No, the girls who don't know how to share are
the fucking yeah.
I don't think Jotaro has the physical capability of being a thought, even if he tried.
Yeah, no, I can't even argue with that. No, he's very much like a traditional kind of dude.
He's a nice, respectable young man who is aggressive to women, just like other nice, respectable young men.
So because of his cut, he has Joshua has to go to the narcissist office, who starts stabbing people.
Also, she tried to take off his pants, so that was really sus.
Scissors.
Yeah.
Yeah,
battle forward.
Like, what the fuck?
To go on a mad one.
Yeah.
Stab some dude in the eye, which, when I first read it, kind of made me kind of uncomfortable because I have always had a thing against eye injuries. It always makes me ick.
Yeah.
Like, fictional or whatever, seeing something get jabbed into the eye socket kind of makes me ick.
Yeah. And then guess who comes in to save the day at the window?
To save the day.
Save the day.
Yeah. Holding a puppet, by the way.
Kakyoin's... It's only Mr. Noriaki.
Kakyoin's very artsy.
Hey,
yeah.
The whole puppet thing is not necessary. He was just doing it for the style point.
Exactly.
Yeah, because he's a nice guy and he's showing a visual representation of what's going on.
It's like, hey, I'm doing this with my stand. This is what it is.
Oh yeah, did we like explain what stands are?
I guess we should kind of get more into it because, and we should explain the stands we have so far. First
stand.
Okay, you can explain.
Okay, oh. So when the.
I also forgot to talk about the opening theme.
Oh, we'll get to that when we.
Stand proud.
Yes. So stands are a physical manifestation of your soul. They appear through various methods that we will get into later because they come up later. But in this essence, all you need to know is Dio got a stand, therefore Joseph kinda, and Jotaro got a stand. Now they are called stands because they stand with you. A lot more simple than you, Persona. Come on now.
Man.
And
Joseph's stand is definitely the, definitely a great way to stand with someone. Joseph's in particular.
So the stands we have seen so far, in detail anyways, is Jotaro, which is pretty much enhanced speed, enhanced reflexes, and strong punching. That's essentially what it is.
Speed, precision, and
insane
punching.
Eyesight.
Yep.
Yeah.
And throwing capabilities.
And then we got Alduos, which his ability is pretty much fire.
Yeah. Magician's Red. He creates heat. I think he embodies everything to do with heat. And he can manipulate fire in any way, shape, and form.
Oh, that's hot. That's hot.
And now we are introduced to a new stand, the Hierophant Queen.
We also... Hey, you can't do Joseph dirty like that.
Yes,
we showed
yes,
his...
They did not introduce his stand yet, did they?
Yeah, they did.
Yeah,
when
no,
they were in
the
cafe.
Cafe.
When they were in the cafe, he karate chopped that camera and it printed out a photo of his deepest desire.
Oh, such a useful stand.
Well, he can. He has vines. Vines are cool. They're purple and hermit like, I guess. So, hermit purple. And there's also Holly Stand.
Which we haven't been introduced to yet, so we can't.
Yet.
Oh, damn. Isn't that? Oh,
yeah, no.
Okay. Wow, spoilers for the next sex. Six.
Ruined everything!
Alright, we have to redo the whole episode now.
Okay.
God damn.
Bye, guys.
Give me hard liquor.
Oh shit.
You only have your old with the queen man.
So we
add an extra
now...
add an extra O molecule, damn it, we gotta
now it's ooh. Ooh. So of course Joe throws.
I'll put a W in there as well. Ooh, ooh.
Oh no.
Oh wait a minute, hold
oh,
on,
no.
What is
you have
oh,
ooh,
no,
ooh,
no,
with
no,
the queen.
Oh, whoa.
So you added fucking tungsten into his drink!
So speaking of oh, whoa, Jotaro kisses the nurse. Why?
We did explain how that queen yet.
Well, we're about
we're
to.
We're about
we
to see it first.
Fight.
Yeah.
We're about to see it.
Alright.
So, oh, whoa, Jotaro kisses the nurse, ooh, ooh. I hate myself, and I actually want to.
And he...
And pulls out Hierophant
He sucks the stand out of her mouth.
Well, Well, when he gets out, the stand went inside her mouth and bit off her pet queen outside of her, which is incredibly weird, honestly. Guys.
Yeah.
Anime is definitely for kids.
Yep.
No.
And next is one of the best speeches in all of fiction. I love the I'm a judge speech.
What?
And his, Jotaro's speech, when he's like, yo, I've done a lot of horrible things. I've left restaurants without paying for the food because...
Wait. Let's do this justice here. Oh, wait, you have it up?
I'm pulling it up now. Hold
okay.
on, wait.
I have it up here.
Oh, God.
Like, we gotta do this justice here. Because this is an actual copypasta randomly, but...
What?
Randomly? No, it's because it's amazing.
Well, yeah, there you go. Well, do you want to do this? Because I know you're...
Yeah, of course.
I, Jotaro Kujo, am labeled a punk. I tend to overdo on my opponents in a fight, so much that some are still in hospital. There was one idiot teacher who was all talk, so I taught him a lesson, and he hasn't come back to school. At restaurants that serve me lousy food, I leave without paying the bill, all the time. But even I know nauseating evil when I see it. Evil is when you use the weak for your own gain, and crush them under your foot. Especially a woman. That's exactly what you've done, huh? Your stand is invisible to the victim, or the law. Therefore,
da,
I shall
da,
judge
da,
you.
Da 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 da.
Choking him.
Yeah.
Ooda
yes.
That's from that, I think. I think it's literally just "I shall judge you."
Yeah. That is the.
Something like that. That's the voice clip in Jump Force.
So, anyways.
Oh.
How that cream is bitten out when we see the most defendable attack.
The Emerald Splash!
Yeah, and that is an insane ability because what it does is... How does it... hold on. Wait, so how are the crystals... Are the crystals formed in the water? Or are they behind the water and the water shoots them out further? Is it water?
Let's see.
Nobody knows.
I would know Wikipedia. Emerald Splash is Hyperfoot Green's most powerful ability. It gathers energy into its body, causing a... glow bright green. Before firing off a large amount of energy, it takes the form of emeralds. Before the blast is fired, a green slime-like material, or water-like in anime, is produced in Hyperfoot Green's hands. But a byproduct of a large amount of energy to attack is off. So nobody knows.
Yeah, pretty much. In other words, bullshit.
Everything is bullshit when it comes to anime. The only thing that's even slightly explainable is... Anyways.
Exactly.
Yeah, I don't know, you're lying, April probably has some
reality. Calculine was pretty defeated pretty quickly in this fight.
Yeah, he got shook.
He got destroyed.
And then all of the ketchup packets that he had in his coat burst all at the same time.
Like, this was hardly even a fight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There was Kool-Aid everywhere.
And yeah. The episode ends with Joseph explaining Cat Queen is going to die soon.
Isn't that a good thing?
Dude!
Right?
Dude tried to kill every... Dude tried to kill him. And he said that, so he's like...
But then they explain, no, Dio mind controlled him. This guy's too sexy to be evil.
That is true.
So it was like, there must be a way that he's being controlled. And Abdul's like, well, actually, he has a flesh bud on him.
Wait, really? When was this implanted? Before or after the painting?
Nobody notices until now.
Exactly.
So Jotaro, with more precision than a brain surgeon.
And by the way, we're now, but...
Oh, yeah.
But before we talk about the brain surgery, let's talk about Sand Cloud.
It's a fucking...
I will say, that opening theme just gets you hyped.
Yeah.
That's probably... It's really weird because it's like when I think of my favorite openings, I'm thinking Bloody Stream, I'm thinking number 9, I won't say the name or whatever, because even the name is yokes. But when I actually listen to them, I'm like, Stand Proud is like really good. It's like really good. It's like really, really
I'm always sad to see a JoJo opening go. But, like, goddamn, it's... Every JoJo opening is a fucking banger in its own way.
Oh, absolutely. There was not a single miss. There was one or two that are, like, 8 out of 10 instead of 10 out of 10, but all are consistently 9 out of 10.
Yeah, legit.
Like, there's only, like, one or two anime openings in the existence of Zawarada that I would give 10 out of 10. I don't know, like Black Clover opening 3, and
but yeah,
this
way to opening.
Yeah.
So, Jotaro decides, since his stand has precision, maybe he has a precision of a brain surgeon. Who knows? Let's try it.
So, Jotaro places his hands on Kakyoin's cheeks very gently, as a random ghost comes out and yanks this thing out of Kakyoin's head while Joseph is screaming.
Wasn't translated the best in the anime, but in the manga, this scene was intense.
Yeah. Yes, like, it was.
Like, to be fair, I don't think this could be ever translated well into the anime.
Yeah, no. I feel like, weirdly enough, this would be like the only scene that would actually probably work better in live action. Like, it just, because when it's animated, you kind of just expect, like, perfect movement, but as a human...
Reading the manga, you felt the nerves. Like, I wanted to give this scene justice because it's one of the scenes that is never talked about, but it's so good.
Mm.
And it's one of Jotaro's better moments because, hey, that type of focus and precision is beyond respectable.
Mm-hmm.
Especially the high pressure situation he was getting himself into, not even knowing that he was going to try to take over his own brain.
How much of that is Jotaro? How much of that is Jotaro, not Star Platinum? Like, how much control...
Star Platinum is Jotaro.
Yeah.
The stand has to rely on its user to keep calm. If Jotaro starts panicking, the stand will start panicking.
But Jotaro never panics.
Yes.
There was not a single time where Jotaro was panicked. And I love that. He gets.
But now it's... And we actually get a nice little callback after he takes the bed out. Joseph uses some hormone to finish off the blood because it's technically Dio's breath.
Exactly.
And that's like the only thing that Hamon does, right?
Yes.
For a long time, if ever.
But then tragedy strikes. Because in the next day, with everything going on, people are doing the routines and notice something is off.
The most menacing spoon ever.
Boom, boom.
Well, the scene where Azula walks into the kitchen and sees Holly on the ground. This is also a pretty shocking scene.
Casual things.
Well, yeah.
That happens could... all the time in the Jumpstar household. That spoon.
Yeah. But...
our pure girl Holly fucking has fallen unconscious.
Your pure girl Holly. I don't claim her.
Me neither.
Too bad. Too bad, comrade. We serve the Soviet Union.
But yeah, and I'll explain what happens real quickly to make it make sense. Her body's not conditioned to control a sand, and the sand is fighting itself.
I thought it was her fighting spirit isn't enough. It's not like her actual body.
It's her kind nature lacks the willpower to control the stab.
Yeah, she's too pure for Azanga.
She's too senso.
She's too say so.
You don't say.
She can't handle it.
So I guess that would be solo levels of say so, eh?
Yeah.
Oh.
So the whole.
I think she's the only one who is still say so at that point.
Yeah, yeah.
So the Mad Lads themselves all unanimously step at the exact same time out the door. All readied up. They're like, okay, we'll fix this.
Kathleen's like, yep, I just met you guys for a few seconds and you saved my life, but that lady I'd fall in love before. I'll help you guys.
Which labeled Kakyoin eternally in the meme community as a MILF hunter from that day forward.
It is kind of a weird phrasing of joining the party. If I'd ever fall in love, that would be the type of girl I would have joined your quest to fight great evil.
And, then Jotaro is the second person to draw in the series.
Yep.
He stares at a very, very blurry picture and finds.
And he's like, zoom! Enhance! Zoom! Enhance! It's such a good and accurate drawing that Kakyoin never draws again because he knows that he can never be that good.
But before we go too forward, I really did like the pacing in the scene of there was an odd nature going on and everybody felt something was odd.
Yeah.
And it took the outsider, our duo, to find what was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is actually really good moments. And our duo, pretty much the one time that the exposition is nice and needed, our duo explained everything so well that made us all understand, all right, that makes sense, here's what's happening.
Avdol is actually a descendant of Speedwagon now. In my head canon.
He's a better Speedwagon because Speedwagon explains things for no reason.
Cop practice.
You take that back now. Speedwagon is best girl.
I don't get why people like Speedwagon so much. He's kind of annoying.
Bruh. The Maple Shamrock does not condone the actions of our of our colleague. Please do not come after us with knives and forks.
Or do. Interaction is great, even if it's a mob.
Even the dislikes may move us up into algorithm, so that's cool as well.
Yeah, so we'll go from 10,000 place to 909.
Oh, gosh. Heel turns.
Good.
Anywho, so we are... So we get the
ridiculous single step scene, and we get a preview of the next villain.
Yes. And then Avdol turns to Jotaro, and he's like, yo, in case you haven't noticed, all these stands are named after tarot cards.
Here, oh, yeah.
Tarot card. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that.
Wait, can I not name mine Ocean Man? No. Pick a tarot
card. Tarot card. You know what?
Wait. How did Calcree came up with Hellfire Queen? Like, did he randomly pick up a tarot card in between? And it's like, yeah, this is a Hellfire Queen.
I mean, I assume here's it would have been, like, Dio who gave it to him through the squid buddy yokimajigababadoo.
No. Because Kakyoin had that from when he was, like, such a small child.
But did he have a name?
Well, we don't know, yeah.
But I don't.
It's kind of ludicrous to have something for that long and not name it, right?
He probably named it, like, I don't know, what's a
slimy emble dude?
I feel like he probably would have given it a more generic name, like, I don't know, let's shout us out there, Turrup. I don't know. Or Kale, or something. Like, its name is Hierophant Green because of the Hierophant. That's what your thing represents.
But yeah, our next episode is the Tower of Gray.
Yes. Y'all like planes?
Joseph sure does!
I'll say, this is actually a pretty sick fight episode.
Sort of. It's good. Yeah. Like, I love Partria. Partria is, you know, my favorite part, but it's far, far, far from perfect. It is entertaining, but, well, I'll explain as we go on, but basically how the episode happens is everyone's on a plane.
We start
on
off
with
Dio killing some ladies.
As you do.
Yeah.
And the old lady, Aina, starts explaining that she sent assassins after the group, and that's where we meet the Tower of Gray, killing people on the plane, as you do.
Just, like, three in a row. That was just, like, that was just a kill streak.
Mm-hmm.
That's, like, impressive from a minor, like, from a villain that isn't the main villain.
And Jojo tries to fight, but his stand is not quite suited for this. And this is where the series starts going, different stands have different suitabilities for combat. Because this is where Kakui takes the bull by the horns.
Now, it should be noted here that it says that where the fact that Jotaro does have some pretty fucking precise hits, but you know what's not precise?
A bunch of emeralds speeding at 100 kilometers an hour.
One stray emerald in the wrong fucking place and that plane would have gone down just as easily as if anybody else had fought that. I just want to preface that by saying.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah.
Jotaro's stand would have been more useful. Because of how precise it is.
But here's the thing. It's not about the precision. It's about the fact that Tawakwe is too fast because he has speed of assistance, but Kakui is faster.
Than a bullet?
Apparently. It's a stand.
Well, and I mean, in that case, then.
Yeah, so what Hellfire Queen can do, and what it did, is set up a trap which Kakui got into, and that's how Hellfire Queen won. It wasn't about the Emerald's fast, it was about the trap it set up with the Emerald Splash.
Yeah. I mean, that is true. But, like, even still, firing the thing in the plane was not a good idea.
Not at all.
He knew where he was aiming. He put it in those seats and was able to put his little tentacle things. Because Alpha Green has tentacles.
Yes. I don't even think it has. No, it has legs, and sometimes it doesn't.
Well, it makes its body into somewhat tentacle-like.
Yeah.
And that's how it was able to hit Tao Gray when he least expected it.
Yeah, that's true.
Because Tao Gray's like, oh, Emerald Splash is pretty useless against me. And then Calculus like, yeah, but that wasn't what I was going for, bitch.
Yeah. And this is where freaking stand battles can be so cool, because it's about using your brains and what you have to find out a solution to things.
And this was really the first stand battle to really do that. That's why it has to be noted.
the Avdol Jotaro thing, that was just like a tutorial. Like, this is the first episode.
That was!
And Jotaro versus Kakarin wasn't even a fight.
No, it was just a straight up beatdown.
Yeah.
However, I feel like that was a really good example of knowing what you have and using it accordingly. Like, Jotaro knew that he knew that only stands can fight other stands. So when he know he couldn't pull out the Hierophant Green out of the nurse, so he got.
But I think this was a fight that also changed things up, and this is also sort of actually being more comfortable letting side characters take the spotlight every now and then.
Oh, because this was literally the second time. Oh, first time that's ever happened.
Really? Because even with Caesar's great episode, he ended up dying anyways.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So this was the first time he actually let a side character take full control of a battle and win it. So it's something to put in there.
Mm-hmm.